So welcome back, and it's a great pleasure to introduce Professor R.Shankar. I've known him for more than 35 years, I think, now, as a friend, colleague, and collaborator. Professor Shankar graduated from IIT Delhi. He did his master's from University of Delhi. He did his PhD from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. Then he did his postdoc in a couple of places, including IMSC, and then joined the faculty of Institute of Mathematical Sciences in 1991. Right? So since then he has been in Institute of Mathematical Sciences. He has varied interests. He started his thesis was in high energy physics, formal field theory, and then gradually he switched over to condensed matter physics, and further broadened in the last decade or so, since the tsunami event in 2004. His interests have been very varied. He has been looking at the tsunami, modeling the tsunami, then modeling the glacier movements in recent years. He goes twice every year to the Himalayan glacier at Mana, and he has been studying the movement of these glaciers for the last few years, and again not only taking the data, also analyzing the data and modeling the movement of glaciers. So in some sense he is in the thick of this physics of climate change, and he's going to tell us a little bit about that work. It's a general talk. I don't know how much of his own work he will cover in this, but he is bang in the middle of this whole field. Shankar.
So thank you, Murthy. So actually I will not be covering any of my work in this, since my work involves glaciers, which is sort of looking at the effects of climate change on glaciers. Here I'll be talking more about some of, initially I gave the topic basic physics of climate change, but that is a bit too large, so I'll be more specific really. I'll be talking about the physics of the greenhouse effect and global warming. So global warming is what really is what is triggering off or forcing the climate change. Since the atmosphere is getting warmed, then automatically the whole climate system gets affected by that. And so that is why this is the thing that I'm going to be concentrating on. So first let me say a little bit about weather and climate, the difference, the two. So weather we define as the state of the atmosphere at any point of time. What we mean by state of the atmosphere is it's what you call specified by these properties. Temperature, wind, precipitation, humidity, pressure. These are the things that you can see on any website, weather site, or in the newspaper that come every day. And these, of course, are constantly changing. All these quantities, the temperature is low in the night, high in the day, the wind varies throughout the day. So all these things are constantly changing, hour by hour they change, day by day they change, etc. So why is the weather constantly changing? So basically the earth is getting powered by the sun, the energy that comes from the sun. And as you can see, the angle at which the sunlight comes keeps varying. So the angle at which the sunlight comes makes a difference, because that is what determines how much energy is actually being deposited over here on the ground. So in the morning the angle is very large, in the afternoon it is almost perpendicular and it's hot, I mean more sunlight is coming, evening it goes. So it changes throughout the day, and then it changes in the seasons also. I mean the summer the angle is different from what it is in winter, which is why there's a difference in the weather at these two times. And then it changes place to place. In the North Pole, the angle is very different from what it is at the equator, and it varies into this thing. So the and then plus the surface of the earth is also not uniform. How much of the energy coming in gets absorbed changes place to place. So the heating of the earth is very inhomogeneous in both space and time, and that's why once the atmosphere gets heated, it will expand. That will cause wind to go from one place to the other. So this inhomogeneous heating, both in space and time, is what causes weather to vary so much, both in space and in time. But however, this the sun has a periodicity of 1 year. So the same pattern repeats every day, and then it repeats every year. So when you take the average weather over many years, typically 10, 20, 30 years, that is a much more stable object. That varies less, and actually it's an easier problem, even physics-wise, to figure out what the climate is doing than what the weather is doing. So climate is defined as the average weather, average typically 10, 20, 30 years, decadal scales. There's no hard and fast definition about that. And now the climate has also always been changing, but really the worry at the moment is that it seems to be changing much more rapidly than earlier, and we'll talk about that just now. So the people have been studying climate almost ever since the physics came into being. So the first question was asked in 1824 by Joseph Fourier. Fourier is the same guy who did this Fourier law of conduction, so he studied heat transfer. He invented the Fourier transform in order to solve the heat equation. And this is a paper he wrote about what the question he's asking is, what sets the temperature of the earth? In the sense that the average temperature of the earth is around 15 degrees centigrade. Why is it not 100? Why is it not 200? Why is it not minus 100? What sets it at 15 degrees centigrade? So he actually did not have the machinery and the relevant physics to answer this question fully, but he made an attempt, and in the process was the first to discover this effect that we call the greenhouse effect. So before we go into that, let us, because in 1824 even thermodynamics was just being formulated theoretically. Experimentally, of course, heat engines had been made, steam engines were working, so people knew a lot about it in the previous century. But the theoretical basis and the conceptual basis of heat and thermodynamics was just being formed around this time. But anyway, so we'll not go down the historic route, so let us get down to some basics. What do you mean by temperature? Temperature, as we know, is the degree of hotness or coldness of a body. But now we have a microscopic understanding of temperature, and that is that we know that all material is formed out of constituents of basically molecules, and those molecules are not stationary, they're always vibrating or they're always in motion. And so this is a picture of a solid that there can be a time in which when the solid doesn't move at all, and that is what we call the atoms of the solid or the molecules of the solid are stationary, loosely speaking, and that is what we call absolute zero temperature. Then as you put in energy into the system, they start moving, and roughly speaking, the temperature of a body is the average kinetic energy of its constituent motion of the constituents. So when you warm and cool a body, what you do is that you put in energy into a body, it gets converted into the kinetic energy of the molecules and it gets warmed up. You take out energy from a body, then the kinetic energy of the constituents decreases and it cools down. Now we can start addressing Fourier's question, what determines the Earth's temperature? The Earth is getting warmed by the radiation that comes from the sun. So let us first ask this question, why does the sun radiate energy? Why does the sun shine? So the answer to this can be given at different levels, of course, but the basic answer to this is it shines because it is hot. And all hot bodies radiate energy. It's not just the sun. A furnace, a gas stove, you and I are also radiating energy. And so that is what we call thermal radiation. So now, what is thermal radiation? So when you can feel the radiation from any hot body, you bring your hand close to it, you can feel the heat coming into your skin, even though there's no wind flowing, and even though there's nothing else connecting that body to you, and that's the radiation that's coming in. This radiation is actually just electromagnetic radiation. We know that now. Of course, in the time of Fourier, it was not known. Why does a hot body radiate electromagnetic waves? That's because each molecule is actually, though overall electrically neutral, it has a charge distribution. So each molecule has suppose we have plus sign over here, positively charged nucleus and a cloud of electrons around it. When it is stationary, it is just both this is static, and all the energy is balanced, everything is fine, nothing is happening. But once you increase the temperature and they start colliding with each other, the electron cloud also gets deformed, and you can have a polarization, or you can have it looks like the center of charge of the negative electron cloud may not be at the place of at the nucleus where the positive charge is concentrated. So this is like an electric dipole. And this is, since things are colliding, it's constantly vibrating. So this is like a constantly vibrating electric dipole. And that is what radiates electromagnetic waves. The basic principle of electromagnetism is that accelerated charges radiate electromagnetic radiation. So for example, in the antenna of the cell phone or of any device that sends out electromagnetic waves, you make the charge oscillate in the antenna. When they oscillate, they automatically accelerate, because they are decelerating. When they stop, then they accelerate back, and they are always accelerating. And so these accelerated charges will radiate electromagnetic waves. So that's why a hot body always will radiate electromagnetic waves. So thermal radiation is nothing but electromagnetic radiation. Now, what electromagnetic radiation itself, you know, has a wide spectrum of waves. So these are the very long wavelength waves, which the radio waves or so on. Then we have the microwaves, then which are micron size. Then the infrared waves, which we can't see. Then there's the visible spectrum of the light that the eye is sensitive to. And then further shorter wavelengths we call the ultraviolet waves. Then for X-rays, gamma rays, etc., etc. So there's this entire spectrum of the electromagnetic waves we characterize by their wavelengths or frequencies, and there's entire spectrum of wavelengths and frequencies which manifest in different types of waves that we call. Now, what is the thermal radiation, what are the frequencies or the laws of thermal radiation? So those were, what is relevant to us are basically these two laws. One is called the Stefan-Boltzmann law. Essentially, it says that hotter the body, the more the energy it radiates, which you can see is intuitively reasonable. And the precise form of how much energy is radiated is given by this formula, that T to the power 4, and that's called the Stefan-Boltzmann law. This was discovered in 1867, but much after Fourier, as you can see. He didn't know about this. Then the second law is called the Wien's displacement law, which says that the hotter the body, the shorter the wavelength. And this you can, that it radiates. So this you can actually experience. You take any nail and put it on your gas stove. Initially, nail gets hot, you don't see anything because actually it's emitting in the infrared. Then it becomes a red glow, which means it started emitting in the red region. If you keep doing it, it becomes, so that's what we call red hot. Then you keep heating it more, it will become whitish, it will turn blue. That means most of the radiation now is becoming, emitting the blue. And if you keep heating it even more, but by the time, if it does not melt, it will start emitting in the ultraviolet. But, so this is the, the two basic laws, that hotter the body, the more energy it radiates. And the wavelength depends on the temperature. Higher the temperature of the body, the shorter the wavelength of the radiation. So if you look at, so that means that the sun is around 6000 degrees Kelvin, the temperature, and that corresponds to a wavelength of visible light. That's why most of the energy of the sun is coming in the form of visible light. Now, the earth is also not at zero temperature, it's also at a finite temperature, so it is also shining. We can't see the earth shining because it's shining in mainly in the infrared region. So, earth's temperatures are, this is 15 degrees centigrade, so it's about 288 in absolute, and that corresponds to infrared radiation, 10 microns, and we can't see this, but we can definitely feel it, and in fact all these night vision cameras, etc., make use of imaging in the infrared. In order to make out warm bodies around. So now we are in a position to say, okay, what sets the temperature of the earth or anything that is getting warmed by something. So the energy is going in from the sun and that's heating up the earth. And the earth is also hot, so it is also emitting and it is, sending out energy. So imagine that suppose you just, the earth was there and you started the sun shining suddenly at zero. The earth will start warming up and it'll, as it warms up, because of Stefan Boltzmann law, it will emit more and more energy. So at some point of time, the amount of energy it is emitting becomes equal to the amount of energy it's absorbing. And at that point of time, it's neither gaining nor losing energy and its temperature becomes constant. So this is what we call the energy balance. And this energy balance is what sets the temperature of the earth or any other planet or any other body that is getting warm. Why is this thing at constant temperature? It is getting light and heat from various parts of the thing because it is also emitting and it's emitting as much energy as it is gaining, and that's why it's at constant temperature. So temperature will change if either the incoming energy changes, which actually it does at very large scale times, or the outgoing energy changes. But so this is the basic principle. So now let's come back to Fourier. Fourier had a vague idea of this. He didn't formulate it in these terms because he didn't have the machinery. But nevertheless, he asked this question, okay, how does the atmosphere affect this energy balance? And how does it affect the thing? So he say, as he says, he didn't have the theory to do it, but he had an experiment which was basically like a solar cooker experiment that has been done by some people called the hot boxes. This is a kind of setup that we had set up in math science as a demonstration, that you have a container and this is three compartments separated by glass plates. And just keep the container out in the sun and measure the temperature of these three compartments, and these are three thermometers measuring that temperature. And you find that the bottom one is very hot, is 94, 81, 68. So temperature is decreasing as you go up in the thing. So Fourier said, okay, I can understand this hot box, why it's happening. Firstly, of course, he says that it's getting heated because you're not allowing the air to escape. And that's why it's getting heated. That is fine. Then he realizes that the heat of the sun has properties different from those of heat without light. So in our language, we'll call it visible part of the spectrum and infrared part of the spectrum. He didn't know that this was electromagnetic waves, but he realized that there is, the what is coming in is, so he called it heat with light and heat without light. So he says that, okay, then the rays, the glass is transparent to visible light, and you can see, that's why you can see through glass, because it is completely transparent. And he says it heats up the vessel, and this heat without light is blocked by the glass. And that you can see glass does this, because you suppose you hold a candle over here and put a glass plate, you'll be able to see the candle, but you put your hand here, you won't be able to feel the heat. So glass blocks out the heat, it somehow blocks infrared radiation, it blocks out, but it is transparent to visible radiation. And so he says this is why the bottom part gets heated up, it absorbs all the heat, and the glass is blocking heat going out, and that's why it's getting cooler as it goes up. Then he made a leap of imagination or whatever, and he says maybe the atmosphere is behaving like glass. Because he knew that when you go up, when you gain height, it becomes cooler. So, for example, this is the to temperatures of Madurai and Kodaikanal, both in the same region, but except one is at almost sea level, the other is about 2000 meters above sea level. And you can't read it, but the average temperature in Madurai is about 30 and this is about 15. And this is general experience that when you go up to hill stations, it becomes cooler than it is in the heat. So he says that he drew the analogy that the atmosphere seems to be behaving like this hot box. And so something in the atmosphere behaves like glass. And he couldn't go further than that. And but people followed it up. So next set of experiments, this was 1861. This paper written by a physicist called Tyndall, who did careful experimentation as to what about transmission of radiation through various types of gases. And so he was asking this question, basically, what in the atmosphere makes it behave like glass? And so he said, and what he found is that the chief influence is aqueous vapor, which is the old-fashioned name for water vapor, and carbonic acid, which is the old-fashioned name for carbon dioxide, and any of the hydrocarbon vapors. And they knew that, you see, you can see every variation of this constituent must produce a change of climate. So they knew that once, you know, this, since these are what nowadays we call greenhouse gases, that since these are the things that stop the infrared from escaping, then any change in the concentration of this will have an effect on the energy balance. Because once you stop the infrared from going out, you're decreasing the amount of energy that is going out. And so you're changing the energy balance, and so the temperature will become higher. And then in 1896, by this time, thermodynamics had developed. People knew about Stefan Boltzmann's law. Wien's law was known. Planck distribution was not known, but enough was known about the other things. And so this was Arrhenius in 1896, made actually a quantitative estimate of the greenhouse effect. So and his conclusion, he lot of it's very interesting the way he got his data and did this estimation. Very lot of work went into it, which I won't go into detail. But his basically his conclusion was that if the carbon dioxide concentration doubles, then the temperature will go up by about 5 to 6 degrees centigrade. So by the way, this is nowadays the modern estimates using all much better data, large computers, etc. don't very differ very much from this. Instead of 5 to 6 nowadays, I think the number would be 3 to 4. So it also sort of shows that if you're doing calculating average things, then simple physics often gives you a pretty close answer to the correct answer. So actually, as you can see, the study of this climate and how carbon dioxide or greenhouse effect is going to affect it was developed concurrent with the theory of heat itself in the 1800 to 1900. At the end of 1900, people knew, not everybody, it was not a widespread this thing, but at least a set of scientists knew that if you increase the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it is going to have effect of warming the climate. But it was not, it was still at this stage a conjecture, and basically you should call it a theory based on some evidence, but not direct evidence. So then in the 20th century, people, this was the first systematic study done. He knew about the work of Arrhenius, etc. And he also estimated that, 20th century, so industrial revolution was well on its way, meaning it's so he estimated that actually large amount of carbon dioxide was being put into the atmosphere. So it should cause a perceptible warming. You should be able to see the warming due to that. Can you see it? So he analyzed a lot, as he says, he analyzed things from about 200 meteorological stations. Also by then, Meditations had been set up in various parts of the world and this kind of data was available. And his, so you can see one of this is Allahabad somewhere here, Allahabad, India. One of them is this thing. So various, so it was, and he estimated that actually world temperatures are increasing at a rate of, actually this amounts to 0.5 degree per century. 5 degrees in 1000 years, so 0.5 degrees per century. Not completely convincing, but this evidence was there. Then second question is the carbon dioxide actually increasing? Now Callender's estimate was also theory. He estimated from estimates of how much factories are burning, how much CO2. Now is it actually going into the atmosphere? Is it getting absorbed by the ocean? Is it getting this thing? So actually is the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere concentration goes going up? So this was a set of experiments done by Charles Keeling in Hawaii. He had set up a lab for various technical reasons. That was a convenient thing. And this graph represents 10 years of very hard work. So you can see 1958 to 1968. And but it unambiguously showed that there's a steady rise in the carbon dioxide concentration. This going up and down is a summer winter effect, which the thing. So these are called the Keeling curves after his this thing, after Keeling's work. So this was a definite, very definitive answer that yes, the CO2 concentration is increasing, and from Callender's work you knew that the temperature was increasing, and all of it was consistent with the theory of Fourier, Tyndall and Arrhenius. Yeah. Pardon?
312 to 360.
Yes. That's right.
So if there are errors, could he still say that it's
increasing? No, so you can see the error bars are negligible over here. And there's a steady trend. So from here you can, if it were just up to here, you may not be sure, but this whole graph shows us. So this steady trend is, you know, few parts per million per year. And so in fact, his thing led that it'll concentration would double over 600 years. Yes, so that is actually a summer-winter effect. That's because basically the northern hemisphere is more land than sea. So most of the plants are there in the northern hemisphere. And so in winter, in the northern hemisphere winter, they will be doing less photosynthesis and so absorbing less CO2, and that's the effect of this oscillating thing. So by about 1950, there was data, hard data to show that these theoretical expectations of Arrhenius, etc., seem to be borne out. So after 1950 was a lot of huge amount of data collection, large number of meditations set up, plus 1950 is when computers came in, so large amount of computer modeling was possible, detailed theoretical modeling of the climate. See, these models of Arrhenius, etc., are very crude, overall rough models. You can't take that as proof, because the climate is a very complex phenomena. You can only take them to be indications. They are rough, back of the envelope type of this thing. But after 1950s, much more detailed computer modeling became possible. And also, if you say that the Earth is warming, when you say it's warming fast, you have to ask compared to what? Meaning, for example, this 0.5 degrees per century that Callender showed. Is it alarming or is it anyway climate is changing? Is it just normal? So you have to compare it with how the past climate changed. Because as I said, climate is always changing. It is never stationary. So the lot of major progress in after 1950s was in what is called paleoclimate. That is techniques in finding out what the climate was in the past. And one very thing which I find very striking
is the so-called ice core analysis, which started in 1957. So this is in the Antarctica. The logic of this is that in Antarctica, the temperature is always freezing, always below zero. So whatever snow falls becomes ice and doesn't melt off, it just stays there. So as more and more snow falls, I mean, the ice just keeps building up. It actually is flowing away perpendicularly to a slow extent. But basically, so as you dig down in the ice in Antarctica, what you're seeing is that you're seeing ice that was deposited there many years ago. Now, the ice, originally it falls as snow which has got a very porous structure. Then it compresses to form ice. So in that process, you can see that there are many small bubbles of air get trapped in the ice. So you have a record of the atmosphere as it was many thousand years ago. And these small bubbles of air are enough to do a complete chemical analysis. So you have a record of what the chemical composition of the atmosphere was many thousand years ago. I mean, hundreds of thousand years ago, as you'll see. And plus, you can actually look at the, there's a technique by which you look at the ratio of different isotopes present, D2O to H2O, or O16 to O18 in the water, which gives you an estimate of what the temperature in the past was. So this, as I said, I mean, it's easy to say it, but in getting, doing this analysis, doing, getting the temperature out of it, lot of work is required and lot of things to do before you get your techniques perfect. So 1857, the first ice coring started, but the first papers came out 30 years later. And by 2004, it was, the technique had been, I think, well developed. And you had a record of about what the CO2 concentration and the temperature was for 650,000 years ago. This shows you an amazing graph of up to 450. So this is the present time, this is 100,000 years ago, 200,000, 400,000 years ago. Now you can see that the temperature has, this is the temperature, it's always been changing. There were hot periods, cold periods, hot periods, cold periods. So these are what we call the glacial cycles. And these cold periods over here that you see are all the, what we call the ice ages. During these cold periods, large amount of the earth was filled with ice. And you can see roughly, this, it's got a periodicity of, there are these ice ages once in every 100,000 years. Now, why is this temperature variation occurring? Now, it is believed that this is due to, because the of the incoming radiation from the sun changing. That is because the Earth's orbit around the sun, if there were no other planets around, it would be a perfect ellipse. But there are other heavy planets around, it's not really a Kepler problem. So the Earth orbit changes slightly. So two things happen. One is that the 23 degree angle tilt, that changes. And the other thing is that the ellipticity of the Earth's orbit changes a bit. So this ellipticity changes once in 100,000 years. That is causing this main 100,000 year cycle in the glacial cycles. And there are other periods of 20,000 years, 40,000 years, which is due to that tilt angle changing. But now if you look at how fast does this, are these changes occurring, you take this part of the graph, which is the steepest part, and just calculate from, by the way, this data of the, all this ice core data is available on the internet. So you can download it and do all this analysis yourself. It's a lot of quite interesting things to do. Anyway, so if you take this part and look at the slope over here, that corresponds to about 1 degree in, typically the average slope is about 1 degree in 10,000 years. The sharpest slopes that you see here are 1 degree in 1,000 years. So 0.1 degrees per century. So when the temperature calendar finds is rising at 0.5 degrees per century, it is in some sense 5 times faster than the fastest natural rate. And you can see current thing, we are nowhere near that fast. We are at what is called interglacial. So it should not be so, it's really very large compared. And after that, now in the past century, as you'll see, the rate at which the globe is warming today is about 1.4 degrees per century. So that's about 10-15 times faster than ever before. And plus now you can see there is also the carbon dioxide concentration. And this is the 300 parts per million. It was less than 300 parts per million for about in the past known recorded history, except now it has suddenly started shooting up. So this sort of is correlated with the temperature. How exactly it's correlated, there are some issues and debates and so on. But suddenly this has started shooting up and the temperature has also started warming. So this is record of the carbon dioxide concentration from various techniques. So you can see that suddenly in the, so this is 10,000, 5,000 years ago, and so at this scale of thousands of years, which is the scale of the natural climate change of glacial cycles, etc., it looks as though suddenly we have put in a pulse of carbon dioxide into the air. This is the way it changed, this thing is blown up over here, and you can see that this rapid rise has come basically after the Industrial Revolution. So this is the same lab that Keeling did his original measurements. They've been continuing to do the measurements, and you can, so this is 1960 to this thing, steady rise. And so they also, if you go to their website, they'll tell you how much it increased in the last year. That is 2 parts per million. So that's about the rate we saw there also. Changes about 2 parts per million per year. But it's a very, very steady rise going up. And so now it has reached 400 parts per million. And it was never more than 300 parts per million for the past whatever ice core data we have, 650,000 years. So what about the temperatures? Temperatures also, now we have large amount of med stations all over the world. And different agencies collate this data and bring out these curves. These are all in the net, how they do the collation techniques, they do everything is there in the net. And you can see again, after about in the 20th century, there's been a steady rise. And this is about, this is minus 0.6, that's plus 0.6. So about 1 degree in the rise in the 20th century. These are warming rates of cities in India, which has been plotted from the IMD, the India Meteorological Department data. So one thing you can see here is, of course, we say global warming, but the warming is definitely not uniform. It's a complex system. So some places it's warming at a higher rate, some places at a lower rate. So for example, over here, Patna, you can see it's, to within error bars, there is no warming at all. Chennai, on the other hand, there's a very definite trend. Kolkata, there's a definite trend. Delhi also, there's hardly any trend. Srinagar, there's a definite trend. So the warming is not at all uniform. The average, it's when you say global warming, you mean average temperature of the earth or average temperature is going up. It doesn't mean that every point on the earth is getting warmer. Okay, so finally now we have also, as I said, with after 1950, once the computers came, you could start doing numerical modeling of the climate. And that you can see, this is one of the first papers, and it is 1966. So when the first, and this is another famous model, which is 1988. So that's the time when models started getting a bit realistic. And the computers were powerful enough, and the models also started getting a bit realistic. And so 1980s, I think ice core data came, computer models came, station data came. So that is when the World Meteorological Organization set up this IPCC in order to try to influence, to warn the policymakers of the world. And so end of last century, it was sort of quite clear, evidence coming in various directions. And all these models, so what these models do is they actually discretize the entire atmosphere of around into small blocks. Any computer simulation, you can't really treat space as a continuous thing. You have to discretize it. And they solve the Navier-Stokes equations, which are the equations that control the flow of the air and the thing. So typically they call all these programs, they have two components. One is what they call the dynamical core, which numerically solves the fluid mechanics equations of the fluid flow and heat transfer equations. And then there is what is they call the physics package, which inputs all the various processes. For example, at what humidity will the cloud form? Then if there's a cloud, under what conditions will it start raining and precipitate? These are lesser known questions. In fact, the physics of clouds is one of the poorly understood parts. And so you can see there are a huge number of processes that go into this physics package, and not all of them are very well understood. So climate models do have that this thing that is, they are not very fully understood things. But nevertheless, what they predict is that they confirm that the temperature rise is closely tied up to the greenhouse gas concentrations. So these are the predictions for various scenarios of greenhouse gas concentrations by forcing. So essentially the lore is that whatever you do now, however much we control the greenhouse gases, we are committed to a 2 degree centigrade rise by the end of the century. If you don't do anything at all, it can be as large as 4 degrees by the end of the century. And this is how well they do against observations. So this is the temperature data for the past 100 years. And so there are various, what do you mean by 58 different simulations? The thing is that when you solve for this, you have to give it an initial state of the atmosphere. Then the computer model will tell you what the state of the atmosphere is later. So initially, what was the, at 1900, what was the temperatures, pressures, various points of the earth? You have to guess. So these 58 simulations would have different initial conditions. So solving the same equations for different sets of initial conditions, and that is the, what you mean by different. So you can see that at least the global temperature is reproduced pretty well by these simulations. And they are getting a bit more accurate. So this is the grid size in 1990, which is about 500 kilometers. So when you discretize, the smaller the grid size, the more accurate is your computation. And the more powerful your computers, the smaller you can make the grid size. So in 1990, the grid size was about 500 kilometers. Nowadays, it's more like 100 kilometers. So improvement of 5 times in the accuracy. So as I said, you can't take, and you can see this is the observed things, and these are the predicted values at different points of time. It's only roughly right. So you can't say that the climate models are 100% right, even in predicting the average thing. But they're all consistent with all the data that we have seen and all the basic physics of the greenhouse effect. Everything is consistently saying one thing, that basically if this curve keeps going up, that is the amount of greenhouse gas concentration keeps going up, then these curves are definitely going to keep going up. The temperature is going to keep rising. Once the temperature keeps rising, the average temperature keeps rising, then the wind patterns, various other climatic factors will also automatically change, because those are governed by the inhomogeneous heatings. So there are predictions like, for example, the extreme events like cyclones and heat waves, cold waves, etc., will increase in frequency. These types of predictions are not so robust. The models don't get them completely right. So what will be the effect of the climate change on ecosystems, etc., another big question which unknown. But what I think is unambiguous, where the simple physics, complicated models, all the observations are consistently telling us, is that if the concentration of greenhouse gases keep increasing, the average temperature of the Earth is going to keep increasing. Thank you for your attention.
It's a long-term Earth climate, that curve.
Yes.
Do you have the effect of lengthening of the day, sir?
Which one? This, just 1 minute.
Due to that glacier studies.
Sorry, with the ice core data curves, yes, you are talking about? This one?
Yes.
Yes.
Do we have any effect on the lengthening of the day? Like today is like 24 hours. Previously it was not like that, sir. The Earth
you mean the period of the Earth changing?
Yes. I mean time period of a day. I mean, yes. It was like from 6 hours when the Earth formed, and then it got slightly increased, keep on increasing. 12 hours, 16
hours. So this is till about 650,000 years ago.
Yeah, that time we have one slightly hours of difference between current day and that time of day.
Okay, so I don't know about this. So I don't. But my feeling is, the how fast the Earth is spinning shouldn't affect things very much.
Because
it's a total energy balance which is counting. And the spinning of the Earth, which is the length of the day, the angular velocity, that makes a huge difference to the wind patterns, etc., because of the Coriolis force. But my feeling is overall energy balance should not get affected very much. But that's just my feeling. I don't know for a fact. Because the rate at which it is spinning doesn't affect either the energy coming in or the energy going out. That's right. Yes, so maybe daily patterns will change, but the average, I mean, as I said, I'm just offhand saying what I feel, so may be wrong. But the energy coming in depends only on the sun. Energy going out depends on the state of the atmosphere and the Earth. Now, of course, it could affect it in a secondary way, that the spinning rate can affect wind patterns, which in turn can affect. But I'm not aware of this, and nobody generally talks about this effect.
It may affect weather, but not
climate. But not, that's my feeling. Yeah, it may affect weather, but not climate.
Short.
Sorry?
Please, go ahead.
I got a bunch of questions about so you said that sun radiates the energy and Earth too emits its radiation, right? So
yes.
Other planets also should be getting the energy radiation, and it should also be radiating out.
Absolutely.
So for example, Mars and Venus are the neighbors of Earth.
Yes.
So when they keep rotating, they do come near Earth. So they too emit radiation. Does that radiation affect the Earth?
Oh, the radiation that comes from the
other planets.
That I think will be negligible compared to the radiation that comes from the sun.
Okay.
So I don't think that will affect.
Okay. And that northern lights, auroras,
yes.
do they give radiation to Earth, or they are just
yes.
Particles? They are just coming in.
They do radiate light. But again, that will be negligible compared to the amount of sunlight that's coming in. They are in a small part of the world and not very intense lights.
Okay.
So,
and then, I have heard that in olden days they used silver nitrate spray to get rains. So does that change the composition of atmosphere, and does it contribute anything to greenhouse effect?
So silver nitrate per se is of course not a greenhouse gas.
Okay.
But water vapor is a big greenhouse gas. But then again, it depends on the scale at which you do these things. Seeding of the clouds is what you're talking about. I mean, this, putting chemicals to form nucleation centers and make it rain.
Yeah, yeah.
Those are all done at a very small scale.
Okay.
You know, maybe it's done 3 times, I mean, 1 or 2 locations on the world, few times. So they are far from being done at a scale which can affect the global climate.
Okay. That's it. Thank you, sir.
There are no more questions. We'll move to Jam.
Yeah.
Who does this kind of research in India? Are there degrees?
Something about, you know, someone who wants to get into this.
Yes, so there are several places. Indian Institute of Science, there's a center called the CHAOS, Center for Ocean and Atmospheric Studies. They do climate research. They do a lot of research on the Indian monsoon. See, for India, how will this climate change affect the Indian monsoon is a very major question, because we are heavily dependent on the, our lives are sort of ruled by the monsoon. So they do a lot of work on the Indian monsoon. There's a DHR Center for Climate Change in ISC Bangalore, which also is a part of this. Then there's this Pune Institute, IITM, Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology, I think. They do a lot of climate research. These are, I think, the main centers, two main centers that I know of. There will be departments like JNU does a little bit, the School of Environmental Sciences in JNU. And I'm not sure of others. But I think these two are two of the big centers in India.
What about glacial studies of glaciers? That's also done in these places.
That is also, yes, this Divecha Center has a glaciologist. And see, glaciers are, I think, they are not central to climate. Because the climate affects the glaciers quite a bit. They don't feed back. They are not big enough to feed back. So they are not a central issue for climate change itself. They are part of the studies of effects of climate change. That a larger number of people do. Sorry?
Degrees. You do, can you study it for masters?
Degrees? Oh. No, so I think it'll be, I don't think there will be degree in climate change. Atmospheric sciences, ocean sciences. Maybe ISC has an M.Tech in climate science, I'm not sure.
It's National Institute of Oceanography in Chennai.
NIOT.
They have, I think, masters, which probably is attached to the IIT.
Yes, they'll have masters, but it'll be in on atmospheric science or ocean sciences.
Yes.
I don't think climate science as such. I've not heard of a degree in climate sciences. Climate science is also sort of interdisciplinary. Ocean science, atmospheric sciences, it's a combination.
I have a question.
Yeah. Yes.
How do you decide that? I mean, what ratio should be to decide that it should be negligible?
By actually estimating them. So, like for example, when I say that I thought that the this day shortening effect is not going to be a big role, this is just my intuition, may not be correct. You have to actually estimate.
For example, you said the auroras and the poles are negligible. So, when do you say that?
So you have to estimate how much radiation will come in from those northern lights compared to what is the radiation coming from the sun.
Yes, is there any hard bounds that if it is less than that?
Sure, you can. What do you mean by anything less than about 1%? I would say negligible. It's not a strict definition. What do you mean by negligible? But typically, the whole accuracy of your entire calculations are typically few percent, not more than that. So anything that is less than a few percent, you not going to make much difference to you. But that's generally how we say what is negligible, that you have some idea of how accurate you're doing your entire calculation or your modeling, how accurate it is. And effects which are much smaller than that won't make a difference.
Sir, you didn't talk about the role of entropy, because sun emits radiation and earth also, it's, but what is the role of entropy in this entire scenario? And another thing is, because of this increasing temperature, is there any considerable deviation in the Maxwell velocity distribution so that some amount of molecules go away from atmosphere? Is there any considerable?
The second question is, Maxwell distribution changes with temperature.
Yeah, that's true.
So, but if, okay, if the system, so suppose I take a part of the atmosphere and so much, let me answer it and see if I'm answering your question. If a system is in thermal equilibrium, then the distribution of speeds will follow Maxwell's equation, Maxwell's distribution. What you may be asking is the climate change fast enough to make it deviate from equilibrium large enough that, or I think not. In all the models, will be that you're very close to equilibrium. These changes of 1 degree per century, I don't think are fast enough to change your move it far away from the equilibrium distribution. You see, in any case, one thing is that the whole Earth's atmosphere system is a hydrodynamic system. So, it is not truly in thermal equilibrium. So, there in hydrodynamics, the assumption is that you take each part of the system and it is approximately in thermal equilibrium and you can use thermodynamics for each part of the system. Otherwise, what do you mean by temperature varying as you go up the atmosphere? Temperature is supposed to be constant for a system in thermal equilibrium, cannot be changed. Because truly the system is not a thermal equilibrium system, but we believe that it's well described by hydrodynamics, which means that locally it's in thermal equilibrium. That picture is not going to get changed by the rates of climate change that we have.
So we'll thank Shankar for.
And about entropy, actually, I don't know. Maybe Gautam can say something. Energy balance is the main thing. Energy balance? I mean, it'll be related surely, but I don't know how exactly or what the issues are there.
So, let's thank Shankar for a very beautiful talk. I wish there were many more students to hear all the talks.